świata. Я пока не очень хорошо говорю по-русски, но недавно я узнал много нового в жизни в России из вашей музыки. Например, что в Питере пьет, и что самая лучшая машина — это Lada Sedan Баклажан. So, my name is still Bozhidar, and I'm still very glad that you can read it. This allows me to remove a lot of slides explaining my name for other less bright foreigners. And I'm extremely happy to be back here. I don't know how many of you have been here 3 years ago, but this was a monumental event for me in several ways. I was invited to speak here, and after coming to the conference, I ended up working for TopTal, which was really fun because I really hated recruiters at conferences, but I wasn't recruited by recruiters, at least then. I was recruited by this guy, the best CTO ever, with a very tricky tactic. He buys you expensive Russian vodka, and he tells you, you are going to drink with me until you sign a contract with my company. So if you see Alexander, by all means, spend some quality time with him. So this started a really fun chain of events all over the place. I met really the best team, and I went to the craziest parties all around the world. I really improved my office environment a bit. And more, I was taught how to raise Series A funding the right way. This is us preparing for the funding, and we were very successful. This is us doing a semi-successful on-site meeting. We went to all sorts of places. We chased all sorts of crazy people. Pictures. This is a crazy Russian karaoke party, but you can't see this. Those Russians with me were very, very crazy, and they taught me everything I know about Russian music, and everything I don't know about Russian music as well. So, some embarrassing moments along the way. I am trying to show you that remote life has ups and downs, and a lot of great sunsets and sunrises, and I also happened to make a lot of friends in Moscow. This is a picture from the after-conference party 2 years ago. So I really owe a huge thanks to everybody who made this great event happen, all the people, the organizers, the sponsors, whatever. And it probably should be bigger. So большое спасибо from me, because coming to Moscow really changed my life in a very, very positive manner. And I came not so far. I was told that during the Soviet day, there was a saying that Bulgaria is not abroad, and some other thing that I forgot. So this is a picture of Sofia, if you're crazy enough to ever visit it. As you can see, the scale in Sofia is different from the scale in Moscow. This building happens to be one of the tallest buildings in our city, and it was, of course, built by the great Soviet nation. It used to be the headquarters of the Communist Party in Bulgaria, and it had a huge red star. Still, very big, very, very majestic in a small town. Going back to some more serious things, Emacs is still the one true editor, which all Ruby developers should be using. It adds plus 10 to all your Ruby skills and to some of your debugging skills, SQL skills, and it also makes you look smarter overall. I still do a lot of open source. You might have heard of two of my projects, Robocop and Cider, if you're into Clojure. And in the recent years, a lot of people started calling me Master. So that's convenient, because people call me Master, and I'm a Rubyist, so I must be the Master Rubyist. And you know what we're thinking? Things got really real. I know what Nick Sutterer is thinking, because I can read his mind from a significant distance, and he's pretty close, so it's easy. Being the one true Ruby master makes me uniquely qualified to present to you a talk on the subject, The Road to Ruby Mastery. It was supposed to be the long road to Ruby Mastery, but it was too long to fit on a slide. So, and also a bit intimidating, so I shortened it. So, what is a master? This is something pretty vague, and when I'm faced with something vague, I always consult a dictionary. So the dictionary told me that a master is somebody having or showing very great skill or proficiency in something. I know that this is still kind of vague, so let me make it really simple for you. This is a master. If you're familiar with how crafts are structured, usually there are three levels in the ladder of craftsmanship. You begin as a novice, at least in English. I don't know how it is in Russian. Then you become a journeyman, and eventually you become a master. When you're a novice, you apprentice with a journeyman. When you're a journeyman, you're apprentice with a master, and eventually you can have a shop of your own doing pottery or ironwork or something. So what is a novice? According to the dictionary, a novice is a person new to something or inexperienced in a job or a situation. To make it visual, this is a novice. And what is a journeyman? Well, a journeyman is a worker, performer, or an athlete who is experienced and good, but not excellent. To make it visual, it's not really very, very apparent, but this is one very lame person about to become a very cool supervillain. There are alternative models of the skill acquisition ladder. I really like the craftsman way because it is simple to comprehend. In recent years, the Dreyfus model of skill acquisition has been gaining more and more traction. It is really great, although it's a bit more complex because we have five levels instead of three: novice, advanced beginner, competent, proficient, expert. I encourage everybody to look it up, read a little bit about it. It's really interesting, but I'll stick to the traditional things. So, the road to mastery. What is this mythical beast? And why is it important for us? It is important for us because I believe that every good professional is driven by the desire to do better, to become more knowledgeable for one reason or another. Some people just want to, you know, develop the best side of themselves. Some people want to earn more money, which is a super valid argument. At any rate, to advance professionally, you have to level up your skills. You have to road this road to mastery, and ideally, you should reach the end if there is some end. Unfortunately, the road to mastery is a long and winded one. I think it is worse than a Romanian mountain road, and trust me, they are pretty bad, and pretty winding, pretty dangerous, but pretty beautiful. So, from time to time, people would tell you that you can achieve mastery in something really quickly. For instance, you can become fluent in any language in 3 months, but I can assure you this is bullshit. Some people can tell you that you can learn C in 21 days, but I can assure you that you need something like 10 years. And here we get to the first very important point. One of the most influential articles for me that I have read in my entire career is the essay Teach Yourself Programming in 10 Years by Peter Norvig. I won't go into much detail about it because the essay is brilliant and I cannot really do proper justice to what Peter wrote. But the point is that in any line of work, you have to spend a really significant amount of time practicing this work. Otherwise, you are never going to get great. It doesn't happen any other way. So apprenticeship is this process that you are applying, and you're leveling up. So you begin as a novice, you do enough apprenticeship, you level up to a journeyman, you do enough apprenticeship, you become a master eventually. Apprenticeship is, very simply put, learning from others. So this can happen two ways. It can happen directly, if you're fortunate enough to be working with some great people. If you are working with Peter Norvik, probably it is going to be very easy for you to directly learn the art of Lisp, artificial intelligence, Python, and whatnot. But you can also be an apprentice indirectly, and this is what many of us do most of the time. This is learning through books, through presentations, reading articles, and so on. Many people keep telling me that they are self-taught programmers, but nobody is really a self-taught programmer unless they never read a book in their life, unless they never read an article in their life, and so on, because all of those written or verbal or visual forms of narrative are a way that for one person to share their experience with us. So how to become a great Ruby developer? How to become a Ruby master? Well, first of all, you have to become a great programmer in general. You have to start with computer science fundamentals. I know that this sounds really, really strange, but I have noticed that the vast majority of Ruby developers really lack in certain basics. Because of the limited time of this talk, I can't go into many details, so I'll just refer to the topics which I think that every good Ruby developer should be knowledgeable in, and I'll suggest some books which I consider the golden standard. So every developer out there should really understand how computers work, and there is no better book on the subject than Inside the Machine by John Stokes. Another great book on processors and stuff, The Hidden Language of Computer Hardware and Software, very highly recommended from the legendary developer Charles Petzold. Believe it or not, every developer should have solid grasp of mathematics, and they should read at least one book on the subject. There is one book dedicated exactly to the type of mathematics you need for computer science to be analyzing algorithm complexity and so on. So highly recommended and not very intimidating read. Every programmer should read some proper introduction to programming. I believe that there is no better book than Structure and Interpretation of Computer Programs. It's old but gold. It is much better than all the bullshit that we have been fed in the recent 20 years. How to Design Programs is another amazing book. Even if you have been programming for 20 years, you can learn a lot by those books if you have never encountered them. I know that the two of them were revelations for me, and I encountered them relatively late in my career. I had been programming for at least 10 years at the time. Every programmer should have a good understanding of the fundamental algorithms. Every programmer should have a good understanding of how compilers, interpreters work. And every programmer, like it or not, should know C. otherwise, some things become really hard, like understanding operating systems, like understanding network fundamentals, and so on. So all of this I consider the essential minimum for every good developer, regardless of whether they are Ruby developers, Python developers, Java developers, whatever. And now we are switching to more Ruby stuff. Ruby is an object-oriented programming, right? So I guess we all have to become experts in object-oriented programming. It seems kind of obvious, but people often ignore this. Still, people keep repeating, Ruby is a purely object-oriented programming language. At least 10 years ago, this was like the chanting of some sect. It was pure object-oriented programming for the win. Hallelujah. And then switch to Rails. There are many great books on the subject. I'll recommend a few, and I will share my slides, so that's why I'm not really saying anything about the books. But really, you can't be an expert in an object-oriented programming language if you suck at object-oriented design. And let's be honest, the huge percent of all developers out there are really horrible at object-oriented design. They just don't realize it. Going forward, know thy language. Understand the nuances of Ruby. I remember when I was starting out with Ruby that many people were saying that Ruby is such a simple language that you don't really need to learn it. You can immediately dive into the Ruby on Rails framework and you are going to pick up Ruby along the way, which sounded something like the plot of the famous movie, The 13th Warrior. But I can assure you that Ruby is not a very simple language. It's a very, very complex language. For instance, can a simple language have a term like class instance variable? This doesn't sound right. I keep interviewing Ruby developers all the time, and 9 out of 10 people do not know what protected means in Ruby. So better get prepared if you ever plan to have a conversation with me. Most people do not have any idea what is the difference between module function and extend self. Most people have never used refinements and are uncertain what is the purpose of refinements. I myself am a bit confused about refinements, but that's another question. Most people do not know what is the difference between super and super with parentheses. Most people do not know the difference between the 4 ways to compare something for equality in Ruby. And this really leads me to believe that most people haven't read a really good introduction to Ruby, like the well-grounded Rubyist, the pickaxe book, the Ruby programming language book, or something like this. So, that's really unavoidable. You have to know the tool that you're working with. And then you have to start yielding this tool elegantly. You have to gain some understanding. How certain things came to be and so on. For instance, in Ruby, many of the oddly named methods came simply because Mats didn't know English very well, in particular English grammar. But it is what it is. Still, you shouldn't be trying to convince people in something that's not true, that there was some brilliant decision behind this and so on. No, there is just some history. We have to come to grips with reality. Always we have to admit that no language is perfect, not even closure, and that some languages really suck, although they are not going to be named today, as I vouch that I am going to become a better and a more positive person. But you all know the 2 languages that I'm talking about. So it is part of this Grokinka language, understanding its philosophy is mastering its idioms. Because as the famous saying goes, you can write C in every language. I have noticed that in the beginning, a lot of newcomers to Ruby would write some code like this, instead of something more idiomatic. Newcomers to the language would always use the then keyword when experienced Rubyists would never do it. Newcomers to the language would always be using explicit returns, and people who are experienced would not be using it. So also a lot of resources to help you with this. There are some really great books, not a lot of time, unfortunately, but learning the idioms is primarily done by reading some, preferably good code, and by some code I mean a lot of code. The best way to really understand how the masters work is to just inspect their work. Go read the code of your favorite library, of your favorite framework, whatever. This is super, super insightful because conventions are not born out of thin air. People have experimented with one approach, with another approach, with a third approach. They have contrasted them in the wild, and they have noticed certain advantages and disadvantages to all of the approaches. So a lot of work has to be done that's unavoidable, but that's the only way to get where you want to get. The next step on our way is to obtain a notion of style. I have already spoken about this in Moscow a few years ago, so I won't go into many details. I hope that you still remember this tiny little book, The Elements of Style, that is the quickest and most foolproof way to improve your use and command of English. And the ideas from this book were translated to programming, eventually with the book The Elements of Programming Style, which is a really timeless piece, even though it is 43 years old or something like this. We have stolen as a community some of those ideas in the community Ruby Style Guide, and we have developed some tool to enforce those conventions. But the important thing about style is that style is something very personal, ultimately, in the end of the day. So it's not that important what exactly are you doing. It's very important to be consistent, to have a style, to always be writing code in the same manner, at least when it comes to the same project. And ideally, there should be some style consistency between all of your project, all of your projects in a company, in an organization, whatever. And if this somehow overlaps with the broader community, this makes it easier for newcomers to be onboarded on your projects because they don't have to learn new things. You are working as the community is working. And this is also the biggest point for following the community standards, because this makes it really easy for people to jump between projects without experiencing overhead. So, assuming that all of this is done, it is time to deal with the reality that a lot of the time when we are writing applications, we are going to be faced with problems. Problems known as bugs. Because no matter how good developers we are, mistakes are bound to be made, either for technical reasons or maybe because some specification was wrong and so on. So I have noticed that the majority of Ruby developers out there are constantly debugging using puts. That's true. So let's see how we typically debug using puts. That's an instant classic, and it works. But first of all, there are actually pro puts debugging techniques. Funny enough, Richard, who opened today's conference, is one of the experts on puts debugging. He has a very, very nice article on his blog. Aaron Patterson, aka Tenderlove, is another expert. And I'll just skim over this. You know, there are things like source location to quickly find where something was defined. There are things like core, which shows the invocation stack at some point, which is super convenient. We have other useful things like the parameters debug method. You can just read about those. I really hate wasting the time of the audience with things that they can just go and read somewhere. And I can recommend you this article and this article. But I will also tell you that, unlike them, I am not a puts debugger. Maybe because I was a twisted Java enterprise debugger for a very long part of my career, and I actually like conventional debuggers. So I really think that the gold standard in the Ruby community right now is bybug. And I really think that an interactive debugger with breakpoints, the ability to step at a time in the invocation chain, inspect all of the local values and so on, is a much more convenient and powerful experience than anything you can do with puts. So check out bybug. It also has an awesome integration with Pry. If you're not using Pry, you should switch to Pry. And you should have switched to Pry maybe 7 years ago, but still, consider this your usual reminder to switch to Pry because it's so awesome. IRB kind of sucks. And I think that we as a community should really start to profile stuff because I think that the Ruby community is the one that pays the least amount of time to things like runtime execution and so on. People are constantly saying, well, Ruby is slow, Rails is slow. Probably there is not much point in profiling, but there are actually some really good profiling tools for Ruby out there. And I encourage everybody to check out Ruby Prof, mostly for CPU performance profiling, and more importantly, the memory profiler too, because every second Rails application is suffering from epic memory leaks, and people are wasting a lot of throughput, a lot of money on extra servers and so on with this, things that can easily be identified with a tool like the memory profiler. So I think that every Ruby expert out there should really learn a thing or two about profiling. And if you really want to level up, you can switch to JRuby and start using some of the crazy advanced profiling tools for the JVM. I don't believe who was asked about JRuby in the beginning. I think it was Richard. Unlike him, I have used JRuby for a few years in production on a pretty complex application. And believe it or not, this actually works. I was surprised myself, and it works pretty well. It's not very convenient for development because certain tools start kind of slow because of some limitations in the JDK. But the deploying on the JVM with JRuby was really something pretty awesome, at least for this project that we had maybe 5 years ago. I can only imagine that things became better. And as an added bonus, we got such nice tools about the telemetrics of the VM, about all sorts of state, about our application, things that are simply not possible to acquire with MRI. Going forward, the dark and dirty secret of the Ruby community. We are all Rails developers. Even the Russian Ruby conference is actually named Rails Conference, Rails Club, right? This is okay to some extent, but also it has always been disappointing to me because I believe that out of the two, Ruby and Rails, the language is the really special thing. And the framework is just one good project that happened to be built with the language. I know I became a Rails developer simply because nobody was willing to pay me money to write Ruby for something else. But I think that now, 10 years later, there are other options. And I think that we should all explore possibilities to leverage Ruby beyond Rails. 2 years ago, I spoke here about Opal, a really cool compiler that compiles Ruby code to JavaScript code. And this is basically your opportunity to replace JavaScript 5, ES6, or the dreaded CoffeeScript with a language that you actually love. Ruby Motion is your gateway to mobile application development. You can write native applications for Android, for iOS, it's pretty cool. And with Opal, you can be writing React Native applications, so we actually have two great Ruby options. Ruby is a really great language for system administration. In the companies I've worked with, we have created all sorts of system administration scripts in Ruby that are extremely powerful and useful. I'm pretty certain that in this regard, Ruby is at the same level as Perl and Python, which are considered the gold standards. I'm not counting Bash because it's kind of masochistic to be writing Bash scripts in 2017, right? I mentioned already JRuby. I think that this is one of the most underappreciated tools that we have in the broader Ruby ecosystem. Everybody is writing, is running applications on MRI for obvious reasons. Because people are seeing that everybody is doing this, so it must be right. But I think that JRuby is really mature. With the 9K series, they have done such amazing breakthroughs when it comes to performance. It is really out of this world. You should see the comparisons of performance in the latest releases of JRuby and MRI. It looks really good for JRuby and very depressing for MRI. By the time Ruby 3 reaches the promise of 3 times faster performance than Ruby 2, I believe that JRuby might be around 30. So that's something to be considered. We also happen to have some interesting web frameworks worth considering. I believe you are going to hear about Hanami later, right? So I won't mention something, but I'll just say that this for me is the most serious competitor of Rails, and I really believe that Hanami is a better choice if you know from the beginning that you are going to be building a big, rather complex application, because DHH himself repeatedly said that Rails is geared towards newcomers to web development, people who want to build their first website, maybe their second website. So I think that this explains many of the design decisions that people dislike, because people want to use the tool for something that it wasn't designed to be used. So Hanami is a really good alternative. Padrino is an interesting alternative that has been around for a while, built on top of Sinatra, which has been around for even a longer period of time. And I think Sinatra is a really good choice for very simple services, as is Roda, another interesting framework that is very, very underappreciated. I don't know. I really wonder whether Rails is so great or other projects really suck in the marketing department. There is something messed up in our community. This is more or less the technical part of what I wanted to share with you. But there is another aspect to being a master in some technology. You are never done learning, because new things, new libraries, frameworks, ideas are developed, are thought of every day, every week. So we should keep in sync. You should be reading the most popular newsletters. You should be listening to the most popular podcasts. You should be watching the most popular screencasts. You should be going to the best conferences and some other not so good conferences. And you should always be exploring, because I think that Ruby doesn't end with Ruby. That there are many languages that can help us with their ideas, that can help make us better developers with their ideas. I know that when I started to play with functional programming languages in my spare time a few years ago, I really enriched my programming style in Ruby, and I started developing better applications. In particular, I became very distasteful of the constant mutation that is so proliferated throughout Ruby applications, and is the cause of maybe 50% of the technical issues. So spend some quality time with Clojure, Haskell, Elm, really interesting language, Erlang, Elixir. We had a talk about threads earlier today, but I really think that the problem with threads fundamentally is not whether they are useful or not. Of course they are useful, but the real problem is whether they are easy to use or not. Even without the global interpreter lock, threads are notoriously hard to use, to reason about, and so on. As somebody who has written a lot of thread-based applications in C, C++, Java, and so on, I know that nobody deserves to be using threads directly. So we need languages with better concurrency paradigms, and all of the above have better. So this is pretty cool. Racket is a great language where a lot of bright minds from the academia have experimented with really cool ideas that eventually end up in the mainstream programming languages. For instance, very few people know that the latest, greatest feature of Clojure spec, is directly borrowed from Racket. So, cool things. I really believe that ideas from other programming languages make us better programmers. We shouldn't be short-sighted. We shouldn't say, you know, we are Rubyists, ignore everybody else. we should be positive, open-minded, and we should always be exploring. And there is one more thing, you know, the final step of mastery, of Ruby mastery. You should know that at some situations, Ruby is simply not a good fit. So I think that the term Ruby developer is very misguided. There are developers, good developers, master developers. I really don't like putting technology labels on people. She's a great developer, that's great. She's a great Ruby developer, that's a bit insulting. Because how can you be great if you know just Ruby? So I know that that's somewhat depressing and people get wild, but it's true. From time to time, Ruby is just not good enough. But closure is always good enough. And that's all I had for you. It was an honor to be here one more time. Enjoy the rest of the conference. До свидания.
Ребят, у кого есть вопросы?
Oh, hi. Hi, Bozhidar. I have like a little bit of trolling question. Mm-hmm. So you talk a lot about Ruby and other good languages. What do you say about like Go and Rust and these modern languages? Do you have some experiences in it? How do you see they are good enough? Do they teach something good? Do they make progress in comparison?
I understand your question. So I have played enough with both Go and Rust to be qualified to answer your question, I believe. I'm not very fond of Go overall. I think that the language is somewhat beautiful. We need simplicity, but I don't like the driving, the overarching idea that programmers are very dumb and you shouldn't give them the tools to be more expressive. The thing that I like about Go the most is that it really helped promote the idea of communicating sequential processes known as Go, as Go routines, channels, whatever. So for this, I'm really grateful to Go. I think that it's an okay language, but I'm not impressed by it in general. Rust, on the other hand, is a really amazing language. I believe that this is the successor of C that we have been needing for a very, very long time. And I see a very bright future ahead of Rust. They have some really, really great ideas there, ensuring runtime safety at compile time. That's certainly something groundbreaking, that the way they handle immutable data and so on. So many interesting ideas, and you can see in the Mozilla projects that the ideas are actually practical because they are using them. So I think that Rust is a really good language, and it probably has applications outside of its target area to replace C as a language for systems programming.
Oh, thank you so much.
You're
welcome. That exactly I want to hear from you.
Glad to oblige.
Hello, Bozhidar. Thank you for your talk. And I have a question about the Erlang and Elixir stack. What do you think about why is these kind of languages not so popular for the tasks such as web APIs and background processing or general network kind of programs? What do you think about them?
It is historical because Erlang was developed to solve a very specific problem. And this problem didn't involve many of the things that we have to deal a lot in with web applications. In particular, for a very long time, the big weakness of Erlang is that it's really hard to deal with strings there. because they didn't need to deal with strings for the applications they were building for telephone centrals. This is slowly changing, but it is going to take a while. For me, the biggest issue of Erlang is that the standard library is not very well suited for what we need as web developers. This is really going to change, but it is going to take a while. Elixir is speeding things up along because they're coming up with a different standard library. On the other hand, if the virtual machine is not optimized for certain types of operations, like dealing with regular expressions, the performance suffers there. It is complicated, but still I do believe that at least Elixir with its libraries and frameworks like Phoenix is good enough for the vast class of applications that we are developing today with Rails. In particular, I think that the days of full-stack web frameworks are gone. I haven't really wanted to write a full-stack web application in a while. Usually, the web application is a standalone REST API, maybe REST, maybe GraphQL, maybe something else, and a standalone front-end. So that's why I think that we need simpler frameworks than Rails, something without view layer at all, without the complexity that comes with this. The Rails API is kind of a step in the right direction, but the frameworks doesn't really embrace this fully right now. So, yeah, I went a bit to the side, but I hope that I also answered your question in the meantime.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, so I guess there are no other questions. Thanks. Mom. Okay.
Ребят, последний вопросик, потому что не успеваем.
Oh, thank you for your talks. I haven't question in real, but could you please place somewhere your slides, because there are a lot of links on good books and other links, and it could be very useful for many people.
I'm going to upload this to speaker deck, and I'm going to tweet this from my account. This is my, but you can't see it anymore. I will put the hashtag of the conference, so I hope that people are going to easily be able to find it. But the slides are going to be online. That's why I didn't even bother to stop explaining what the books are. Limited time, and you are going to have access to the slides anyways.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.